Hi, everybody. Yes, I'm George Boyle, and I'm here from Fumbally Exchange, where we, I suppose, have a bit of an aversion and an allergy to the term job creation, because we believe that there are no elves up in the attic of Leinster House poring over the leathers and trying to make jobs. But I'm going to go back to something else, really. I'm going to talk about work, and I'm going to talk about it in the context of what compels you. What is the thing that makes you want to do what you do? What makes you want to get up in the morning, and what makes you do what a child does, which is get busy every day embracing progress and learning? And I'm going to start there because I found this as I was cleaning out the old Fumbally Exchange, which we had to leave because we grew out of it, moving into the new Fumbally Exchange. And this was a very stark reminder of how I ended up in the Fumbally Exchange in the first place. So basically, I lost my job. I was with one of Ireland's most fondly remembered architectural practices, Murray O'Leary Architects. And having just had my second child, I was at home. One day she was 5 weeks old, and I was called into the office to be told that with immediate effect, that office was going to be liquidated. And I was one of the people who thought I was in a job for life. So myself and my little daughter went out the door, followed by my husband, who also worked there, followed by our tenants, who also worked there. So we had a bit of a problem, and I knew I had to start my own business straight away. So this was what I would dangle over my little daughter as I was setting up my business. And my business is called George Boyle Designs. And on our on our homepage, we have this poem, and it's a German author, but it translates sort of like this. There was a fence with spaces you could look through if you wanted to. An architect who saw this thing stood there one summer evening, took out the spaces with great care, and built a castle in the air. And I've always thought that that's what being an architect is about. It's about seeing possibility where there are no possibilities visible. And it's about kind of transferring something quite ordinary, or maybe something that's an obstacle or something in the way, into something that is actually very fantastical. Unfortunately, though, at the time that we were forging this new company, we were still kind of remembering the relics of the tough and ruthless era, where everybody was building business on very, very shaky foundations. And they were foundations that we found out to be corrupt, that we found out to have really no integrity. And I suppose that sign there, I didn't do it. What I found was that an awful lot of people who found themselves in the redundant space were very much embracing that victim mentality. I didn't have anything to do with this. This was nothing to do with me. This was all created by other people's greed, other people's problems. And I was just saying, really, we need to do something different about this, and we need to try to gather people together and reclaim what is ours, the authenticity, community, and integrity of what makes us people, what makes us work together. And I also, I suppose, put up this slide because Forbes and the Futures Company recently ran an article about the greatest regrets of the great leaders, I suppose, of corporate business. And to the last man and woman at the top of executive directorships and chair positions, the biggest regret marked was, I didn't start my own business, I didn't go out on my own, I never took that chance. And I suppose what I started with the Fumbally Exchange, I didn't really intend to become what it became, but I suppose I thought it would be an incubator, an accelerator, a place where people could come together to learn how to start a business, to start kind of thinking about doing it on their own and being responsible for themselves. But instead, we've actually created a community that is far greater than I thought it might be. It is an organization that has now got a 4-point mandate. Basically, we help creative professionals not only to start their own business or restructure one once they've been affected by the recession, but we help them to shine. And we help them through that to contribute back to the neighborhoods and communities around them. So our first mandate, even though we're now rough and toothless rather than tough and ruthless, our first mandate is regeneration. So we take the skills in the room that we've kind of gathered, and we try to help the physical environment heal around us. So we spot places where there's dereliction, places where there's vacancy, places where there's problems in the built environment. There's a lot of architects in this community, as you can probably imagine. And while we have some grassroots startups, which are very nimble and very quick and very able for change and for growth and for getting on with it very quickly, we also have a lot of the latter slide there, the people like me, kind of a bit grey-haired and straggly with no roots, but who are actually managing to bridge from one sort of very secure place to a future place, which is far more rewarding than we could have ever thought possible. The urban regeneration program for us has been spectacularly successful. We moved into a building that was 100,000 square feet of 15% occupied commercial space. So that was 85%, am I right there? 85% vacant, and as we left it, it was 97% full. And that brings us on to community. How we did that was we reached out to people who were in defense mode. They were in their garrisons. They were kind of shrinking. They were experiencing what other people have described here as companies, as individuals. I mean, it's not just people who've been made redundant or who are unemployed, who feel the pressure and the terror of, you know, the bailiff coming to the door, the mortgage repayments adding up, the bills that can't be paid, the holidays that can't be had, the things you can't buy your children, the places you can't go. Those are happening to employed people too. But what's happening is that everyone is defending their own private personal space instead of helping each other out and helping each other to get past that place. We used to kind of go to people and just invite them to barbecues. I mean, we did what Lucy said. We kind of blagged everything. There was bartering, there was services traded for goods and supplies. But it meant that we created a really strong community and we managed to bring a neighborhood together, a neighborhood that had been completely disrupted by emigration, by the identity loss created by loss of work. And I suppose the other point I want to make is about innovation. There's never been a better time to get into business. Business is just brilliant at the moment. You know, it's the most lightweight, flexible, amazing thing, because while we were having this awful commercial collapse, we were also having this incredible surge in ICT and information technology, making it really, really easy for us to be light and flexible and to make whole world working almost feasible for anybody. I started my business with 20 euro. That was never a possibility less than 5 years ago. So the ground is glistening with coins. We believe that innovation, by definition, is the art of finding opportunities where none are thought to exist. It's back to what I was saying about being an architect. But this is pure human condition. This is the survival of the fittest. It's the basic principle of evolution. Wherever there have been social paradigm shifts across culture, across history, creative clusters of people have managed to find a new way to make a new direction. And all of those changes, from what I've done in my research, have been positive changes for society. You just have to be a little bit of an opportunist to find it, which is why I have my little Jack Sparrow there. We have been called the pirates of the corporate world. But the other thing that has come from the Fumbally Exchange is learning the true value of people. You know, I mean, most of us kind of go on day to day with a kind of mutual tolerance, maybe respect for each other. But once you really understand people and you understand what compels them, what makes them tick, what really, really is at the heart of what work is for them, suddenly you'll see that there's a possibility for you to connect with them. And if you connect with them, the whole is always greater than the sum of its parts. And we have the strangest collaborations going on that have made it into real business and are now flourishing in the Fumbally Exchange. So that really brings me back to the kind of the last slide, where another woman called George once said, "What is work? You know, work is not man's punishment. It is his reward, his strength, and his pleasure." And that's what I really want everyone to take away from this, that this is a time for great change. This is a time that everybody should feel empowered to step out and to find a way to make a future for themselves according to their heart, as well as all the things that have been said about the impacts of redundancy. What we have found is 150 businesses have now come through the doors of Fumbally Exchange. Many of them were straight out of the Dole office. There are no supports for people who come from the Dole, apart from the Back to Work Enterprise scheme, which is gossamer and is gone in an instant. But not one of those people has gone back to unemployment, not one. Every single one of them is either still with us or has gone on to a better place. So I think the power is there within all of us, and we're now trying to take the vex factor, as we call it, to other places. And we've opened in Balbriggan, we opened in Waterford, we're opening in Cork, Ennis, Galway, Belfast, and we're bringing it into other sectors like music, film, social enterprise, and hopefully together we will all manage to make work together. Thank you.